Good morning and welcome to the 16th meeting of the Local Government Communities Committee. Can I remind everyone present to turn off mobile phones, and as meeting papers are provided in digital format tablets, may be used by members during the meeting. We've got apologies this morning from Graham Simpson, who unfortunately cannot be with us today, and we move to agenda item one, which is decision on taking business in private. The committee is invited to agree to take agenda item four, consideration of its draft report and payments to returning officers in private. Are members agreed? Okay, thank you for that. We now move to agenda item two, which is draft budget scrutiny 2017-18. So this agenda item is split into two panels. For this evidence session on the Scottish Government's draft budget 2017-18, the committee will hear firstly from the Minister for Local Government and Housing, focusing primarily on the housing and communities aspect of the budget. And in doing so, can I welcome Kevin Shute, Minister for Local Government and Housing. Good morning, Minister. And also welcome Caroline Dix, Head of Affordable Housing, Angus MacLeod, Head of Home Energy Efficiency Programmes for Scotland Unit, Barry Stalker, Spending Review Team Leader, Scottish Government. Good morning, everyone. Thank you for coming along this morning. That's appreciated. And can I invite the Minister to make a brief opening statement. Good morning.
Thank you, Convener. The setting of the draft Scottish Budget is taking place against the backdrop of tough public expenditure conditions driven by Westminster. Austerity is a choice, not a necessity, in my opinion. Despite this, we have managed to secure further significant investment for housing, including for our ambitious affordable housing supply and energy efficiency programmes. Our draft budget for 2017-18 shows our commitment to delivering on these, with an increase to the housing supply budget of 3% and to fuel poverty and energy efficiency of 10.5%. I'd like to take each of these in turn, starting with how we are increasing the capital spending on housing supply. The budget document notes that the total spend on more homes will be £603.615 million, which together with the housing programmes for TMDF, which covers Glasgow and Edinburgh, which sit in the local government budget line, means that the total investment will be provisionally £699.704 million. 99% of the Moore Homes Level 4, in fact £375 million of it, continues to be capital funding to be directly invested in the Affordable Housing Supply Programme, chiefly for new social housing. This is a £10 million increase in the equivalent figure for 2016-17 and will enable councils and housing associations to maintain the momentum needed to increase the pace of delivery, which is what stakeholders have asked us to do. This is the most powerful way to invest in housing supply for a fairer Scotland. Turning now to improving energy efficiency. We remain committed to our ambition of eradicating fuel poverty. Latest statistics indicate that around 748,000 households were in fuel poverty in 2015. That's almost 100,000 fewer households compared to the previous year. While this is obviously very welcome news, we know that there's much more work to be done. Around half of this reduction can be attributed to the lower price of domestic fuels during that time, and I'm sure that we all recognise that prices fluctuate. That's why our key focus is to reduce overall energy costs for Scottish consumers by improving energy efficiency in homes where we can. Next year, we will allocate £114 million to tackle this and improve the energy efficiency of our homes, a 10.5% increase on the 2016-17 baseline budget of £103 million. This investment demonstrates our long-term commitment to address the challenges of climate change and also the inequality of fuel poverty in our society. And we'll deliver on this through our existing and developing fuel poverty programmes, which offer a package of support to help those who are struggling to pay their energy bills and keep themselves warm. So overall, despite the tough public expenditure conditions, we will still provide significant investment. I think in the circumstances, this represents a good budget outcome, meeting our commitments to building more affordable homes, improve energy efficiency and tackle fuel poverty. Thank you, Convener.
Thank you very much for your opening statement, Minister. And we'll move to questions. Andy Whiteman.
Thank you, Convener. Thank you, Minister. I'd like to probe a little bit more the housing supply and infrastructure in Level 4, which is increasing by 2.7%, which, as you indicated in your opening statement, is chiefly geared towards building more social housing. Could you say something about what's behind that, those figures? What considerations were arrived at? What considerations were arrived at in terms of the increase? And to what extent does this budget contribute towards your 50,000 target?
Well, this is key to delivering the government's target of 50,000 affordable homes, 35,000 of them for social rent. Obviously, Convener, in order for us to do that, we have to rely on our partners and local authorities and housing associations to collaborate with us in terms of that delivery. And I'm pleased that we have managed to raise that budget this year, and that is, of course, on top of the rise that there was in the previous financial year.
I suppose what I'm after is what's behind the 379 million. I mean, how many homes is that designed to build at what individual cost, etc.? What assumptions are behind those figures?
Well, obviously, in terms of the subsidy which we give to local authorities and councils, which was agreed on January last year. We have a certainty of how much is likely to be delivered when we take that into account, along with the investments that they make themselves. And all of that will come out during the course of the strategic housing investment plans, which are coming in at this moment in time. Obviously, those subsidy levels themselves, after the agreement, are a benchmark figure. And I've said, Convener, that if authorities, housing associations, councils come forward showing that there is a need, for example, for larger homes, 4 and 5 bedrooms, or homes for disabled people, then we will negotiate, allow them to negotiate with officials to make sure that that need is met, and maybe increase that subsidy a wee bit to help in that regard.
So just finally, Convener, do you see when the strategic housing investment plans come in that you will produce some kind of reconciliation between what they're intending to deliver, the budgeted cost, and what you've allocated in the next financial year?
Obviously, Convener, as the strategic housing investment plans come in, I will be keeping a close eye on them. I have to admit to the committee that during the course of the Christmas holidays, I will be my usual anorakish self, because I intend to go through all of the plans that have come in myself to make sure that they are robust and that they will help us deliver on our targets. So the committee can be assured that I will be scrutinising those, and I'm sure that the committee in the future will be wanting a closer look at those plans themselves.
Okay, thank you.
Thanks. Can I just ask for a little bit of clarity, Minister, about those plans that come in from the local authorities? In the case of Glasgow, my own local authority, they, of course, administer the Housing Association grant on behalf of the government. So when those plans come in, do they come with a costing, or do they have indicative figures already of how much money they've got to play with in the system? Does that sit with them for the next financial year, or would they get that at the start of next year, along with, let's say, the finalised revenue support grant?
Convener, you're right to point out that Glasgow and Edinburgh are somewhat different in terms of the way that they're funded. TMDF, as I mentioned in my opening statement, which is the transfer of management of development funding, is the way that they are allocated the money that they need. The plans themselves are costed, Convener, and again, that is something that I will look at over the course of the Christmas holidays. I think that we now have the majority of the ships in. I think there are still one or two authorities that we are still waiting on them to actually give us the indication of what they're going to do. Obviously, Convener, the normal course of circumstances would be for local authorities to take these documents to either council or a committee of the council to agree them before they come to us. So I recognise that in some cases that's maybe slipped a little bit. But you can be assured that I will be looking at the costings and everything else associated with the strategic housing investment plans over the course of the holidays.
That's really helpful, and it's always dangerous asking a question when you don't know the answer yourself, Minister, but I'm going to ask it anyway. In terms of those plans, what I was trying to get behind was that the monies that each local authority will receive via, well, Glasgow Rems are very, very different from the rest of the country, but when housing associations make bids for a grant subsidy, will the monies given in each local authority area depend on the quality of those strategic housing plans and the strong case they make? Or is there indicative figures already exist for spending local authority areas? That's what I'm trying to establish.
Well, they will get indicative figures from us of what their spend is likely to be. Now, I haven't seen in depth any of the ships yet, but what I would also expect from a number of local authorities, and it was certainly the case when I was in a local authority, as well as trying to ensure that you use your allocation, you should also, in my opinion, build in a certain amount of slippage into your planning, because we know that with the best will in the world, sometimes, you know, things do not go to plan. So, you know, you've got the ability to shift on to something else if you possibly can. Beyond that, Convener, and this is one of the main reasons why I'm going to take the overview and have a look at them all, is that I've been quite clear as I've been talking to housing conveners and others across the country. If there is an area that is unable to spend their allocations during the course of the piece, I will shift that resource to areas that can deliver. Obviously, Convener, my ambition and the government's ambition is to make sure that every single part of Scotland benefits from this very ambitious housing programme. But if that stalls in certain places, you know, we will look to shifting resource.
That's helpful. I know Elaine Smith wants to follow up on some of that.
Thanks, Convener. Good morning, Minister. Thanks for joining us. It's very brief clarification at this stage that I wanted. My colleague Andy Whiteman mentioned the sum of 379 million capital, and that's what we had in the Spice briefing. But I had thought in your opening statement, Minister, you mentioned 375 million. Could I just clarify that? Are these two different figures, or is it 379?
It's 379.115 million for housing supply and infrastructure, and 375 million for the core capital programme to deliver the 50,000 affordable houses.
Okay, thanks. I think we just needed to have that clarified. Thank you.
Okay, Ruth McGuire.
Yes, Convener. Good morning, Minister. I'd like to ask about the provision of housing for disabled people and for folk with particular needs and aids and adaptations, etc. Within the 50,000 affordable homes target, have you considered whether there needs to be specific targets for the delivery of wheelchair accessible houses?
Convener, I thank Ms. McGuire for that question. The funding decisions around these things are based on the priorities of local authorities as outlined in their housing needs and demand assessments, their local housing strategies, and also the strategic housing investment plans. And another reason why I'm going to look very carefully at strategic housing investment plans. Housing for social rent already has to meet our accessibility standards. But funding, as I said, is also available for specialist housing. For example, helping folks with much more complex needs living independent lives in their own homes. I mentioned earlier that the grant subsidy that we provide, they're benchmarks, they're not flat rates. And I would repeat what I said earlier about the flexibility of all of this. I've made it quite clear to local authorities and housing associations, if they are going to do something which is above the norm, particularly when it comes to larger houses and housing for disabled folk, you know, we will negotiate subsidy levels around about that. You know, I am absolutely determined to make sure that the housing needs of folk in individual areas are met. That's why I'll scrutinise the strategic housing investment plans as much as I will. Beyond that, I'm aware, having been around and about in recent times, that many places are already ensuring that they are bringing disabled groups in to discuss needs. I was questioned in Argyll a few months back around about a development there and did some exploration afterwards to see what was actually happening. And I have to say that I was fairly happy at the level of communication that there had been between the developer there and disabled groups. Obviously, the government has recently put forward its Disability Action Plan. Jean Freeman has been at the forefront of that. There are elements within that plan which emphasise the importance of housing. And I would want to make sure that the ships take cognizance of what we have committed to in the Disability Action Plan and that we get this right for folks right across the country. As a constituency MSP, I'm aware of sometimes the difficulties that there are in accessing houses, particularly folks with folks with the most complex needs. We need to get this right for everyone.
Thank you, Convener, and I welcome that message around the flexibility where local authorities are wanting to do more. Thinking about adaptations, I mean, this is a thing that comes up a lot locally for me. The Help to Adapt pilot ended in 2016-17. Are there going to be any changes to the budget for adaptations as a result of that pilot?
The adaptations budget has provided resource funding to help registered social landlords to provide housing adaptations for older and disabled tenants. Functions and budgets relating to housing adaptations for local authority tenants, owner-occupiers and private tenants are part of a range of local authority functions that have been delegated under the Public Bodies Joint Working Act 2014 to the new Health and Social Care Partnership. We recently had the Independent Adaptations Working Group report, which recommended that fundamental changes were made to the delivery and funding arrangements for housing adaptations. And their recommendations were piloted before being rolled out nationwide. Five demonstration sites were included initially. That was Aberdeen, Borders, Falkirk, Fife and Lochaber. And they're piloting different approaches to test the viability of the proposals. This work, known as Adapting for Change, will run till the end of this financial year, 2016-17. And an evaluation of that Adapting for Change scheme is being undertaken by Craigforth, and findings are due from them by the end of February 2017. In line with the 2016-17 investment, we'll provide £10 million for registered social landlords to deliver adaptations to help older and disabled folk live at home independently and safely.
Thank you, Convener.
Okay, Elaine Smith.
Thanks, Convener. Just a follow-on from that, Minister. I appreciate you've talked about discussing different options with different local authorities. But in terms of homeless units, for example, I'm sure you'd agree that it's far from ideal for people to be in homeless units for any length of time. But what I've found is that if there's not suitable adapted wheelchair accommodation, then there may not be any other choice. So has any thought been given to specific adaptations in homeless units for councils?
That's an answer I don't have at my fingertips. If Ms Smith wants to give me examples and write to me about examples that she's come across where there have been difficulties, I will certainly look at that. I will also undertake to look at what provisions that we have in local authorities to deal with folks who find themselves homeless with disabilities.
Thank you, Ken.
Kenneth Gibson.
Thank you, Convener. First of all, I'd like to thank you for your comment about if local authorities are being a bit sluggish in bringing forward housing developments, see what the Scottish Government would be looking to kind of step in. I think that's very important. Certainly, it's an issue I would want to discuss with you in a private capacity in the next few weeks. But going back to budget, page 92 of the draft budget, you say in 2017-18 we will help tackle infrastructure blockages through a flexible grant and loan fund. And I'm just wondering what you mean by that, and if you can talk us through it just a wee bit.
Convener, obviously we have recently introduced the £50 million infrastructure fund to unlock housing sites across Scotland. Now, in terms of private developers, they can access loan funding to do this. And I recently announced the first loan of £7.9 million to support development at Granham in Aberdeen. I hasten to add, Convener, that that's not in my own constituency, where 600 homes will be delivered as part of the first phase there, with a potential of up to 4,700 homes coming forward there in subsequent phases. So the idea of the infrastructure fund was to unlock sites where there were difficulties. The access to that funding, as I said, is loan funding for private developers and grant funding for public sector developers.
Thanks. And what impact do you think this £50 million will have in terms of being able to lever in additional housing? Is there any kind of numbers in mind that you have, both private and public?
I think it's very difficult to judge that at this moment in time, Convener, because this is a new fund. It's in its early stages. There have been a number of applications to the fund. There has been some money drawn down. I think one of the key things which we need to do is to make folk much more aware of the availability of this fund, which is something that we will do. So it's something that I will keep an eye on, analyse. It's like everything else that's new. Sometimes it takes a little while to bed in. But I'm hopeful, you know, that we will eventually see this fund open up the opportunities to build much more. As I said, the Granham loan will initially bring 600 homes forward with a potential of 4,700. For a loan investment of 7.9 million. That's a fair whack of houses.
Yeah, it's very significant. That's why I'm interested in it. Thanks very much.
Can I just check, Minister, the reading you have over the holiday period of all these strategic housing plans coming in? Rather you than me, Minister, but I'm delighted that you're doing it. Will these plans, should they also have within them land that could benefit from the fund that Mr. Gibson was talking about. As part of that, should they identify areas of land where there are barriers to development that could benefit from that fund, be it private loans or grants to housing associations or whoever? Would that be part of their strategic housing plans? Should it be?
I would expect that to be the case. The SHIPs themselves should be pretty comprehensive, and I was just checking with Miss Dix there to make sure that the ones that have come in have got some of that in them. So yes, I would expect them to be pretty comprehensive in that regard.
Okay, can I just clarify? A clerk tells us that this committee's been streamed online with the BBC at the moment. People watching this, there will be some minister, and you keep saying SHIPs. Could you perhaps just give
strategic housing investment plans, convener?
Which, of course, everyone around this table knew, but when you talk about SHIPs, others may not.
And I keep talking about the SHIPs coming in, and I actually said it the other day, and somebody responded about good SHIPs in the Ali Ali O, which, of course, is not an acronym.
Yes, indeed, yes. Final, we're going to move to Alexander Stewart in a second. Alexander, that's your kind of heads up that we're going to come to you next. But can I just check, will there be an analysis of all these SHIPs as they come in, and would that be reported on in any way, or would that just be a kind of direct relationship between yourself as minister and the local authorities? Because this committee might be interested to know the dynamics around that as we monitor the 50,000 target going forward.
The More Homes Scotland team will, of course, be analysing in depth the strategic housing investment plans, and will be having discussions with local authorities and other partners about their strategic housing investment plans, and to ensure that they meet their housing need. Obviously, convener, that's a pretty comprehensive piece of work to make sure that we deliver on that target of 50,000 affordable homes over the course of this Parliament. In terms of the strategic housing investment plans themselves, in the main, I would imagine that many of them are already public documents because they will have gone to council committees or to full councils for their approval before they have been sent to my team of officials.
Of course, local authority aspirations, understandably, should outstrip the budget available for affordable housing. I actually hope it does, or else they're not really doing their jobs properly. But will that be pulled together across 32 local authorities so that we would know, actually, in the next 5 years, if local authorities had all the investment that they wished, that would provide not 50,000 units, but perhaps 60,000 units or 70,000 units based on those strategic housing investment plans? Is that something that's pulled together at a national level, something that this committee could perhaps take an interest in going forward?
I think in terms of delivery, first of all, convener, I've already talked about the austere times that we live in, and the fact that our budgets have not fared very well from the UK government in recent times. So in order to up delivery would require significant resource, and I cannot see that coming from the UK government at this moment in time. But beyond that too, even if there were a money tree that suddenly appeared with a large sum of money able to be plucked from it, there is capacity issues in terms of delivery, which we've also got to take cognizance of in terms of the capacity of the construction industry, for example. We've got a piece of work going on at this moment with partners, which is being led by Jim Mather, the chair of Homes for Scotland, to try and ensure that we have the capacity to deliver in terms of construction, and we have the right skill set there. But there are also other impediments which may come into play in terms of delivery in that regard. And if you were to add to it, I think it would be very difficult indeed. And that's things like if we end up with a hard Brexit, for example, about 10% which I think is a conservative estimate. About 10% of construction workers here in Scotland at this moment in time are from Eastern Europe. You know, if we end up with a hard Brexit without freedom of movement, you know, we have to look very closely at what can be delivered.
Now, I thank the Minister for that answer. Now, with all the health warnings, including austerity, and there is no money tree, as I think you said, Minister, would you look towards, if there is an analysis done of these 32 local plans, maybe sharing some of that with the committee so we could decide how our post-budget scrutiny might develop going forward? Because I think that's really what the appeal is, as we kind of tease out how we monitor the move towards that 50,000 target and the funds available.
You know, convener, we are open and transparent. We can provide you with further information. But I think folks have got to understand that what we have is a £3 billion budget over the course of this Parliament to deliver those 50,000 affordable homes. It's the biggest housing programme that there has been in Scotland for decades. It is much higher than the £1.7 billion in the last Parliament. But, you know, £3 billion, if you could persuade colleagues south of the border to release much more capital funding, you know, I would make a pitch that you know, maybe some of that should go to housing. However, £3 billion is the envelope that I'm working to deliver those 50,000 affordable homes. And I think that in itself will keep me going for the next wee while, to say the least. But, you know, we'll share whatever information that we have with the committee.
That's very helpful. And that information, would it be an analysis? Because, I mean, this committee could contact 32 local authorities. We could ask our research team to try and look at 32 strategic housing plans. But what we're asking, all we're trying to persuade just now, is how we can get the most useful information from government to allow us to do our job, which is, of course, and I'm sure will reflect some of the significant increases in spending in the affordable housing budget when we come to do our budget considerations. But our responsibility goes beyond budget scrutiny. It goes to monitoring the Scottish Government's aspirations for that 50,000 target. And any analysis you could give us to allow us to benchmark and monitor going forward, that would be very helpful. So if you give consideration to some of that data being available, that would be very helpful.
We will ensure that the committee gets a summary of the strategic housing investment plans and analysis behind that. That may be a while off, convener, but Ms Dix will be able to do that and provide the committee with that information.
That's very helpful. Andy Whiteman, did you want to come in some of that?
I just want to move on to the rural.
If it's moving on, can we take Alexander first, who had indicated was coming in.
Thank you, convener. Morning, Minister.
Morning.
With reference to the housing support, I'd maybe like to know your views on the additional funding that's coming for the homeless support as a result of the transfer.
Are you talking about temporary accommodation, Mr. Stewart?
Yes, it comes under the homeless support.
We, of course, we'll have a transfer of funding from Westminster for homeless temporary accommodation. I wouldn't call it extra money, to be honest with you, because there are concerns that homelessness services are at risk. The rents and temporary accommodation due to higher management costs generally exceeds local housing allowance rates. Therefore, the UK government's decision to reduce funding for temporary accommodation available through the benefit system represents a significant challenge, not only for the Scottish government and for local authorities, but also for the folks who find themselves in temporary accommodation. The temporary accommodation group has been working on the impact of rent capping on temporary accommodation since 2013, convener. While the Scottish Government is not able to fully mitigate the UK Government's programme of welfare reform. We are committed to ensuring that temporary accommodation is of a high quality and serves the needs of its residents. And we're working with councils and the third sector to ensure that this happens. We're also working with Alacho to consider, and I'll stop there because I reckon that's another acronym, that's the Local Authority Chief Housing Officers Association, for what is a reasonable cost for temporary accommodation provision, as well as looking at how local authorities manage temporary accommodation. We've already begun a stream of work with our partners and local authorities, how best to allocate the resources and funding that will be available for temporary accommodation. We're also in discussions with COSLA to establish a fair model for fair distribution for temporary accommodation funding. And we also need to rethink the role that temporary accommodation plays and see what we can do to improve our use of this resource. If Mr. Stewart is able to talk to his colleagues in the UK government to try and help us out and not reduce the funding, that would be extremely useful for the Scottish Government, for local authorities, and of course for those folks that are in need.
And in responding to that, Minister, do you believe that the homeless services are at risk from the lack of funding that's going into local government with reference to that specific area?
What I believe is that it is a challenging time for Scottish Government, for local authorities and other partners to deal with this constant cutting of these services by the UK Government. And one of the things which is particularly galling, convener, for myself and for my colleagues, is the fact that we are told, you know, that powers are being transferred, but we are not getting the resources that there has previously been to deal with these kind of situations. A similar scenario happened, of course, with work budgets, the budgets to help disabled folk into work, which were devolved with an 87% cut. This, as far as I'm concerned, is completely and utterly unacceptable. And if Mr. Stewart has the ear of ministers at Westminster, I would suggest that he tells them that these kind of situations are unacceptable and that they should treat us fairly. And also, they should stop the slashing of social security and welfare funding to our most vulnerable people.
Would you like to follow up to that, Mr. Stewart?
No, I'm happy. Can
you? Okay, thank you. Elaine Smith?
Thanks very much.
I think it's in relation to this, Elaine's coming in as well.
Thanks very much, convener. Yeah, it is around this, Minister. You said earlier that there wasn't a money tree, which I think we accept, but Shelter Scotland, whilst welcoming the £470 million capital commitment, said that the government had missed an opportunity in not using its new devolved tax powers to raise extra funds, and they warned that cuts to local government core funding risks hitting homelessness services. So whilst no money tree, there was, with the devolved ability to raise tax, an opportunity there to have extra funding available rather than cuts to local government. So I wonder what your comment would be on that, and specifically, could I ask you, there's different types of homelessness, obviously. Specifically, I think we've noticed a rise in street sleeping, certainly in big cities, particularly Glasgow. So I wonder if you could perhaps tell us what specific plans there are to address rough sleeping, street sleeping.
Convener, let me deal with the last part of the question first. In terms of homelessness presentations, the questions that are asked by local authorities are, have you slept rough in the last 3 months? did you sleep rough last night? That's questions that are asked when people present to local authorities. In both of those cases, the percentage of folk who are replying yes are down. 4% and 6%, if I remember rightly. However, those are the folks who are presenting to local authorities. Like Ms. Smith, convener, I've heard anecdotally that there seems to be a rise in rough sleeping, particularly in Glasgow. To ensure that we have the right information, I've asked Glasgow Homelessness Network if they will help the government in terms of ascertaining what numbers actually are. And they have agreed to do that. Obviously, as we move in to the winter months, we will see the opening of the Glasgow winter shelter again, which will give us an indication, again, if there has been a rise. So the committee can be assured that I will continue to keep a close eye on all of this and try and get the most robust data that I possibly can.
Could I interrupt you on that point before you obviously address the shelter comments? But last year, I think the winter shelter stayed open for an extra month.
Yes.
Is that something that you'd be planning for this month, if necessary? This coming year, if necessary,
well,
as well?
That's obviously a matter for partners who run the winter shelter. There was analysis done on what happened last year. I have to be honest with Ms. Smith and say that I only received that analysis on Tuesday, and I have not gone through that in the depth that I would like to. I will certainly do so and have a look at what the findings were from the analysis that was done about folk going through the doors last year and the support that was offered to them. A lot of this, as the committee is well aware, are services that are delivered by local authorities. What I have been doing in recent times is going round various organisations who are dealing with homeless folk and talking to homeless people themselves about their experiences to see if we're actually getting all of this right. Beyond that, I think the key thing for me is preventing homelessness in the first place. And that is why we have put so much effort into the housing options hubs to make sure that local authorities are exporting best practice and making sure that they are getting it right for those folks who find themselves in the tragic situation of being homeless. But prevention, I think, is the main thing. Beyond that, this also has to be an area of work which is cross-cutting across government to make sure that we get mental health services and addiction services and other areas of work to gel in to deal with tackling homelessness. So this is something which is key as far as I'm concerned, and that's why I've been out and about as much as I have been to get a true picture of what is going on out there. In terms of the tax situation, the government laid out its tax plans very clearly in its manifesto in the run-up to the elections. And the tax proposals that was put forward by the Cabinet Secretary were designed to protect low and middle-income taxpayers. but generate extra revenue over the course of the parliamentary term by forgoing the substantial real terms cut that there would have been in the 46% band. I recognise that some parties have called for an increase in the top rate. And the SNP manifesto itself said that we would look at this in 2018-19 after we had ensured that an increase would not lead to reductions in tax because of folks, richer folks, moving their tax situations south of the border. It would be much easier to deal with some of these things if we had more powers to actually ensure that we could enforce. But what we could actually have if we were to raise those rates in the top band is a number of tax exiles going and placing their affairs south of the border and actually taking in less tax, less income for government to spend on vital services if we were to do that.
Okay, I'm also conscious, Minister, that this committee's taken a view on the money that is available in the budget under the heading of local government and communities rather than how that money's raised. So we might just leave that exchange sitting there. That's maybe for one out with this committee. Mr. Gibson, did you have a supplementary on that?
Yeah, it's just on the whole issue. Just to ask the Minister how UK welfare reform is impacting on demand for housing and how that's being reflected in the Scottish Government's choices in relation to this budget.
I think that UK government policy, social security policy, is having an effect in almost every aspect of life for some of our most vulnerable people. The key thing for me and all of the work that we'll undertake as we go forward is to increase that affordable housing supply with 35,000 homes for social rent. But it would be fair to say that some councils, and in particular some housing associations, have real concerns about social security cuts and payments to them through housing benefit because, you know, obviously their investment is reliant on rental funding streams, often which come from housing benefit. So the uncertainties that are created by this constant tinkering and constant cuts obviously has an effect on decisions that other bodies will take. Is something, again, that we have had a fair amount of discussions with the likes of the Scottish Federation of Housing Associations. As it stands at this moment, that is not holding folk back from committing to and investing in the housing programme at this moment in time. However, you know, these changes by Westminster, these constant changes, might lead to a situation where folk become more pessimistic in the future. And that's why, you know, I will continue to have the discussions with the Scottish Federation of Housing Associations and other bodies. And we will continue to relate their concerns about these changes to the Westminster government. They themselves have lobbied pretty hard over the peace on this front, and we will help them in whatever way we possibly can.
And has welfare reform influenced your decision to increase the budget to tackle fuel poverty by more than 10%?
Well, I think, you know, welfare reform has an impact on that too, as well as many other factors. But the government does have that commitment to eradicate fuel poverty. That's a scenario that's going to take some time. We're going to look very closely at the over 100 recommendations that came from the two groups that looked at fuel poverty, the Strategic Working Group and the Rural Group, and that will influence a number of streams of work going forward, which will lead to the Warm Homes Bill. But I think quite clearly, in terms of some of the findings of these groups, yes, UK government welfare reform plays a part in some folk being unable to heat their homes to the degree that they should be.
Thanks.
Okay. Andy Whiteman.
Thank you, Convener. Just a couple of questions, one on rural and one on energy efficiency. I've been trying to find out numbers for the investment Scottish Government's making in specifically rural housing, but I haven't been able to find any numbers. I think you break down expenditure by local authority area. I'm wondering if it would be possible in future to provide some analysis of the spend on rural specifically.
Ms. Dix is looking for some further information. What I would say, Convener, is our commitment in terms of the Rural Housing Fund, £25 million, and the £5 million Islands Fund that I announced just recently, show our commitment. Are we able to break it down by anything else other than?
Yeah, as you said, what we normally do at the end of each financial year is produce a report which gives a bit more detailed analysis about how the affordable programme has been spent, and that is usually broken down by individual local authorities. So that will show exactly what every authority is delivering in terms of homes.
So my question is, given that Scotland is split into remote, rural, rural, urban, etc., is it possible to get a breakdown of that?
We can have a look at that.
Okay, that would be helpful, thank you.
We'll look at it. But I kind of definitely commit to that, because that may be a little bit difficult. But we'll do the best that we can for the committee.
Yep, just bearing in mind that houses have postcodes, so I'd like to think it couldn't be too difficult, but we'll leave it there. On the energy efficiency, Minister, you'll be aware that Existing Homes Alliance has been for some time now arguing for £190 million investment in this coming transition year and £450 million a year by the end of this Parliament to tackle fuel poverty. I'm just wondering, do you recognise those figures? And if you do, have you any plans to significantly increase the investment you're making in energy efficiency?
I've met with the Existing Homes Alliance and individuals from within, and I'm well aware of the proposals that they have put forward. The programme for government has committed over £500 million to SEEP over the next 4 years, which sets out a clear commitment to tackling fuel poverty and to improve energy efficiency. That's substantial public funding. SEEP itself will commence in 2018 and will have that substantial annual public funding. It will be a coordinated programme to improve the energy efficiency of homes, of buildings, not only in the residential sector but also in commercial, public and industrial sectors too. Initial estimates suggest required overall investment of around £10 billion. But it's important to note that that's not just government funding, but should also be from a range of public and, of course, private sources. And we will continue to update this figure, and that will be largely led by the Climate Change Action Plan, which will be published in early 2017. Obviously, we will outline a fair amount more in the Warm Homes Bill. But this is not just a matter for government, and this is not just public funding that we're talking about here. We should also be cognizant that private funding will, of course, come into play to ensure that we make advances in this front.
Yes, Minister, I'm well aware of that split, which is why I used the figure of 450 million, which is the existing Homes Alliance estimate for what's required by public expenditure. Do you recognise that figure, and do you have any problems with that figure in terms of the targets the existing Homes Alliance is setting?
I recognise that that's a figure that the existing Homes Alliance has put forward. As I have outlined already, what the government has committed to in this programme for government is that half a billion pound spend over the next 4 years.
Well, that was our last question, Minister. Can I just thank both yourself and your team for coming along to provide evidence this morning? It's been helpful as we look at our budget considerations. And with that, we'll suspend briefly to prepare for the next witness. Thank you. Okay, good morning and welcome back everyone. We now move to the second evidence session of the Scottish Government's Draft Budget 2017, and the committee will now hear from the Cabinet Secretary of Finance and the Constitution on the local government aspect of the budget. And can I welcome Derek Mackay, Cabinet Secretary for Finance and the Constitution. Good morning, Cabinet Secretary. And can I also welcome John Nicholson, Deputy Director of Financial Scrutiny and Outcomes, Douglas McLaren, Head of Local Taxation, Bill Stitt, Assistant Team Leader, Revenue, Local Government Finance, Local Taxation Policy and Business Rates Unit, Scottish Government. Thank you all for coming along this morning. Cabinet Secretary, I understand you've got an opening statement to make.
Thank you, Convener. I'm grateful for the opportunity to discuss local government finance, including in the draft budget. As I made clear to Parliament, despite the challenging economic and political circumstances that prevail, the draft budget will improve our public services and support our economy. Having held extensive discussions and negotiations with COSLA, I have proposed a full package of measures which I hope that all 32 local authorities can sign up to. The total funding package for local government, as set out in the draft budget, amounted to over £10.131 billion, but once various sums of money from other portfolios were added to the total settlement, as set out in the consultation circular, it amounts to almost £10.253 billion. This includes general revenue and capital grant funding, specific revenue and capital grants, and the distributable non-domestic rates income. The Scottish Government guarantees the combined general revenue grant plus the estimated non-domestic rates income. I'm well aware of my previous committee appearance that members of this committee had some reservations about our commitment to use the extra money raised through our council tax reforms to directly fund schools to help close the attainment gap. We have, as you know, listened to those concerns and decided that this money should be funded from central resources, and we've increased the funding to £120 million next year for the attainment fund. We've also maintained Council's share of capital funding with a £150 million increase compared to this year. In addition to the settlement total, we'll transfer an additional £107 million from the NHS on top of a quarter of £1 billion transferred this year for health and social care partnerships, which will meet the full cost of our joint aspiration to deliver the living wage for social care workers. And this has been warmly welcomed by the Scottish Care and the Coalition of Care and Support Providers in Scotland. And above these sums, and as a result of our decision to fund the attainment fund from central resources, local authorities will have £111 million more council tax income to spend on services, with the option of adding a further £70 million following our decision to lift the council tax freeze. Together with this central funding and local taxation, amounts to spending power rising by £240.6 million, or 2.3%. It's a settlement that invests strongly in education, social care and wider local services before we even count in a further range of funding streams. Funding to support local government services will see a real terms uplift broadly comparable with the Scottish Government uplift in the 2017-18 draft budget. Turning to non-domestic rates, the draft budget outlines our proposals in the context of the 2017 revaluation of non-domestic properties by the independent assessors. The assessors have now published draft revaluations online. To maintain competitive business taxation, I'm not proposing to insist on a revenue-neutral revaluation, but instead propose to cut the rates poundage by 3.7% to 46.6 pence. We'll expand the small business bonus scheme by raising the eligibility threshold for 100% relief to £15,000 rateable value so that it exempts 100,000 properties from rates. We'll continue the large business supplement at 2.6 pence but raise the threshold to £51,000 so that 8,000 properties are excluded and fewer than 10% of properties are liable. Our non-domestic rates income has been considered by the Scottish Fiscal Commission, which has considered as reasonable the economic determinants underpinning this estimate in line with its current remit. In summary, this is a fair settlement for local government, and we're committed to a partnership approach with local authorities to deliver the agreed package of measures, and I'm happy to answer any questions.
Okay, thank you, Cabinet Secretary. You might return to some of the numbers you said in your opening statement, which were very helpful. The first thing to ask might be in relation to the statistics that you use. Can you confirm whether you've used, in comparing to the last financial year, the financial year we're just coming towards the end of in the new financial year, whether you're using draft budget statistics from the previous financial year or actual spend from the previous financial year?
No, it's more appropriate to use like for like, so we compare draft budget with draft budget. It's not appropriate to compare the end year spend with the start year spend. It's two different figures, and I think that's where some people have got their numbers wrong.
That's helpful. Now, I'm looking at two tables prepared as spice briefing for today's meeting, which don't include some of the numbers that you've outlined, some of the spends you've outlined, Cabinet Secretary, where they would look at, if you look at actual spend, they would say there's a 3.2% real terms cut in local authority budgets. But if you look at the draft budget, it'd be a 1.6% real terms cut. And I'll come back on to that figure in a second, but we now appreciate why you're using draft budget with draft budget. So the proposition there is a 1.6% cut. Can you tell me what those figures don't include? So you listed some other spends there which are not immediately obvious within the draft budget document because they don't all sit in the one place. So could you tell me what is not included and what would be a notional 1.6% real terms cut?
Well, there's no doubt about it that local government funding is incredibly complex because within the draft budget document, there's a local government table, of course, and then from other portfolios, there's funding that goes to local authorities and local government services for very specific outcomes. So you have to take that into account. Then there are other matters that will support local government services and local projects, for example, city deals. So there's a range of other funding streams that come into play, and there's other funding streams that are delivered over the course of a year, as well as the demand-led funding streams that exist. So it is incredibly complex. That's why there's figures in the draft budget. That's why you can't just refer to one table on local government finance. You have to look at the totality of funding streams from each portfolio to local government. And as I say, even beyond that, there are other deals such as city deals. We pull all of this together, we send a circular to local authorities to give them their financial position. But even that is supplemented by further funding streams that go over and above that. And that's why when you look at the headline figures, it's a fair and a strong settlement that actually shows an increase. Now, as well as all of that, we have the matter of council tax, where this Parliament has considered the issue of the multipliers, which generates £111 million more for local authorities. Every council keeps every penny of council tax. And by lifting the freeze on council tax, it will ensure that local authorities could raise a further £70 million. But even excluding the potential to raise council tax, the 3% cap that we have proposed, there is still an overall increase of spending power for local government services as a consequence of our budget decisions. Now, if you want more detail of the accountancy of all of this, I'm happy to provide it. Any of the officials can do that. But as I say, it is incredibly complex, but when you play in all the different funding streams, it's a very fair and strong settlement to local government.
Cabinet Secretary, I suppose that's a complex answer for what I thought was to be a straightforward question, which was if you look at those that are saying there's a 1.6% real terms cut to local government, what monies is not included within those numbers? And from your opening statement, this is what I just wanted to clarify, that doesn't take account of the £250 million integration funds that would be transferred. It doesn't take account of the additional £107 million new integration fund monies. It doesn't take account of the £111 million additional multiplier effect from council tax, potentially, and it's up to local authorities, it doesn't take account of a potential 3% increase in council tax if they choose to, and perhaps some other monies. And then the Scottish Government gets to a very different figure from what some local authorities are asserting. I suppose from this committee's point of view, is we'd rather have had all those numbers in the one place, rather than looking between a budget document, a circular, and other documents. So is it needlessly complex? Because I sometimes think, Cabinet Secretary, that it's the job of councils to say they've got the poorest possible funding settlement, and it's the job of governments to say they've got the best possible funding settlement, and the truth lies somewhere in between. And what I think this committee would like to do would be to have all the appropriate numbers that feed into support for local government services in the one place. So Is some of this needlessly complex?
I think that part of the funding mechanism within the world of local government has emerged, and many of us have local government experience. And I think I'm one of the few members when I was in local government that was on a settlement and distribution group within COSLA, because much of this is done in partnership with COSLA, of course, the negotiating body for local government. So much of the complexity has emerged over a number of years in funding and distribution methodology, the needs-based assessment, and then the floor mechanism. You know, it is incredibly complex. And then there is a difference between what's presented in the draft budget, then what emerges in other funding streams, then particular ring-fenced funds, then, you know, further needs-based call-upon resources. Then you've got the separate deals such as city deals, which surely everyone would welcome, Aberdeen, Glasgow, Inverness, so on and so forth. So it is incredibly complex, but I can, you know, draw down to figures that ultimately show the spending power for local government services is increased. But let me say on your key point here, I think it's actually a fair one, that if you were to design from scratch a local government funding arrangement, could you put all of the information in the one place at the same time? Would that be helpful? I can tell it would be helpful for all of us. So what I think we could do is look further at how all the information is provided for future years. But a lot of this is driven by the budget timetable. And of course, the Parliament is looking at reviewing the budget process, partly in light of the new powers that we have, because we're no longer just a spending Parliament, but we're a tax and spending Parliament. So I think it's right that we look at our processes. And that decision to review our processes is further vindicated by the decision of the Chancellor of the Exchequer to change his budgetary timetabling, so that in future, apart from next year where there'll be two budgets, but in future years there'll be a spring autumn, there'll be a spring statement and an autumn budget. Now that's flipping the whole budget process for the whole of the UK. That's profound implications for how we do the budget in Scotland. Now everyone's well aware of my timing of this year's budget, that I had to wait for the Chancellor's autumn statement. There was a consensus around that to be able to have a fully informed Scottish draft budget. So I think there is the opportunity to refine that process, but also I will absolutely commit to look with officials who are, you know, very dedicated and well-informed officials as to how we can try and get as much information in one place and simplify this as best we can. But I say again, convener, in all seriousness and sincerity, that the complexity of local government funding has come from years of process, years of, you know, deals and arrangements to ensure that we make the right decisions around how we fund local services and deliver the needs-based approach. I know, Convener, you've got particular interest around issues such as poverty and attainment and needs, and all of that does feature within the very complex mechanism that exists, and then how we consult with local authorities and their assessment and the negotiations. So, incredibly complex, and then there's the interpretation of the figures. But when you boil it down, when you boil it down to what a local authority has to spend at the end of the day, that's a really interesting question. And then when you go further, what are the public most interested in? I think they're most interested in what is being spent in the services in their area. And that's where you can play in a whole host of funding streams that you can't just discount as an accountancy exercise. You say that's new money, that's real money, that's additional money for things that matter to the population of Scotland. And in all of that, I can point to specific funds and financial arrangements that have supported those services in this budget.
Okay, Cabinet Secretary, could you put it all in one place for us? Ahead of our final reporting exercise on the draft budget, can you write to the committee and outline every single budget line where the Scottish Government asserts that additional monies are going to support local authority services, and we can consider that in detail ahead of reporting in relation to local authority budget.
I will commit to do that, and the only one caveat that I would add is what I've explained, that there are some funding streams that still may land even after that exercise is complete. That'll be more money. That's additional funding streams. Not necessarily new money, but additional funding streams that go to local government services. But I'll absolutely commit to give you that figure, that analysis, as quickly as I can in the timescales that you've set out.
And then our committee can contrast Absolutely. That with assertions made elsewhere about levels of cuts.
Absolutely.
Now, I'll pick one bit of scrutiny in the numbers that are available, and then I'll feed in to my colleagues. Now, had there been more time, we'd have done more of an exercise around this, Cabinet Secretary, but as you've said today, £250 million Health and Social Care Integration Fund monies transferred from the health budget through to the new partnerships, and an additional £107 million on top of that. Now, we know some of that was to deal with wage pressures in the social care sector and making sure the living wage was paid. I know from Glasgow that some of that money has been invested in step-down beds and care home beds to deal with matters of delayed discharge and the like. So some of that would be very real pressures that would sit on local authority social work budgets that they would have to fund from their general funding stream if the integration funds didn't exist. Mm-hmm. So can you put on record what you would consider some of the financial pressures that you think those monies will ease in local authorities?
Well, even on the health and social care transfer figure, and I think it's absolutely correct to say that that transfer has happened before from health to frontline social care. And I'm baselining the quarter of £1 billion in the budget, so that's £250 million, and then, of course, the £107 million, which was and is a matter of negotiation with COSLA. I believe that it does fund the full implementation for the full year of the living wage that was negotiated last year, but this funding allows living wage to be delivered for full year, and then on an ongoing basis in perpetuity, that improves the quality in the system, and further resource for sustainability of service, and also support around, you know, the very specific requests that we made to local government around carers and veterans as well. But every single part of the public sector will be delivering efficiencies at this time. We're all, you know, consuming extra pressures on the public sector, so is the private sector. Incidentally, I may add, for example, the UK apprenticeship levy, but on integrated joint boards, I think we need to understand that this process of integration was you know, a consensual position by the whole Parliament to bring frontline social care together with that health commitment, convener. And as you have described, it's no longer cost shunting, but it's supporting the person that needs their support. It's, you know, it's addressing needs rather than an accountancy exercise or a kind of confrontation between health and NHS and social workers. It's integrating our funding streams and integrating our systems to give the best possible frontline quality care as we transfer from acute to community. So, yes, the right infrastructure at a local level certainly helps with delayed discharges and pressure on the NHS and equally strengthening the community infrastructure is good for the NHS. And I have a number of quotes from across the political parties in support of the integration agenda and how bringing and pulling the money together is also the right thing to do.
I'll maybe ask for you not to give those quotes. I suppose the point I was trying to make, Cabinet Secretary, is partly a timing one for the budget as well, because I'm sure local authorities may have made a different view in relation to the cost pressures that those monies alleviate at a local authority level, although we did give local authority representatives the opportunity to put some matters on the record in relation to that. So that's specifically why I've asked yourself to do the same. I want to bring in Mr. Whiteman next, actually, and then I'll take Mr. Gibson. But just a point to leave hanging, Cabinet Secretary, I think this committee is becoming increasingly aware that there's a huge amount of monies swirling about the local authority area, and we've got an education committee, I would imagine, would look at the attainment fund cash and how that's spent, £120 million. You've got a health committee now looking at £357 million of health and social care integration funds. We have got city deals out there and a variety of other spends. And we're just conscious as a committee, we're not quite sure who's doing the scrutiny, or a consolidated piece of work on the financial position of local authorities and the support provided to them. So that information that you're going to provide us will be a good starting point, but I think we have to do better as a Parliament in how we follow the public pound at a local authority level.
The only thing I would add to that, conveners, there are, of course, audit agencies who do scrutinise the spending and revenue raising of local authorities as well. So they certainly are held to account for what they spend. I would, of course, add that it's not just government grant and council tax. Local authorities also have the ability to raise resources through fees and charges as well, which wouldn't necessarily come through government or come to government for accountability, but that's where the audit agencies would be involved, as councillors and councillors have to get their accounts signed off.
Okay, thank you very much, Cabinet Secretary. Andy Whiteman.
Thank you, Convener. Thank you, Cabinet Secretary. A couple of questions on local tax. First of all, you indicated that you're lifting the council tax freeze, but imposing a 3% cap. How do you propose to enforce that, given that you don't set the rate for council tax for councils? And the second question relates to non-domestic rates, where you're making a cut of £200 million in the revenue deriving from non-domestic rates. What economic assessments have been done as to the economic impact of that cut to the rate?
Okay, fair questions. On council tax, I propose I'm in dialogue with COSLA to see if we can arrive at a partnership deal with COSLA on our position. And yes, one of the asks that Scottish Government has is to ensure that if there is a council tax increase, it's not above 3%. So I am proposing to have a partnership deal with COSLA so to do. Of course, Mr. Whiteman will be well aware that not every council is part of COSLA. So I've written to all 32 local authorities in Scotland outlining the government's offer, which I think is a very fair offer, and what I ask for in return. And for completeness, that includes that cap of a council tax of increase, no more than 3%, maintenance of pupil-teacher ratio and teacher numbers, the arrangements around health and social care. And as I say, these are some of the key commitments I'm looking for. I'm happy to share a copy of the letter that I've sent to every local authority in Scotland to the committee for your information, and you'll see that I'm trying to reach this partnership approach. I've asked for local authorities to write to me by the 13th of January and whether they accept the package or not. Now, I have to say, if the settlement to local government was so bad, I suspect COSLA would have rejected it at a special leaders meeting, but they've not done that. They're considering the package that I've put to them and actually welcome some of the positions that the government has taken, but it's now for local authorities individually to make a decision on whether they support that package or not. I'm not proposing sanctions or imposition or anything else other than a partnership approach with local government. However, if they don't accept the deal, then clearly I'll have to revisit the position, but I hope that we reach that arrangement through positive engagement, constructive dialogue and a partnership approach. On non-domestic rates, the assessment has come from a actual projected income and policy changes that I've made. So I think it is important to support sustainable economic growth at this time. I haven't had a revenue neutral position on non-domestic rates. That would have meant putting the poundage up. It would have meant increasing the poundage higher than it is in England. And that's not the choice that I've chosen to make. I've chosen to increase support for small business bonus, to change the thresholds, to be more supportive on the large business supplement, to reduce the poundage for everyone by reducing it in the terms that I've described. So all of that and distributing actually what we will receive is how I've arrived at the non-domestic rates figure, all of which in terms of the economic modelling has been assessed by the Scottish Fiscal Commission, who have said my assessment is reasonable.
Okay, thank you for that. On the council tax, would you accept then if you propose a 3% cap, that this is not really local tax, this is central tax? You are in effect setting the rate as you are with non-domestic rates. And the question I had with non-domestic rates is, what assessment of the economic impact have you done, if you have done any? Because there is evidence out there by academics in the past in relationship, for example, to enterprise zones, where if you have 100% relief, for example, all that happens is rents go up. It gets capitalised into rent payments if you're a tenant, and it gets capitalised into asset values if you're an owner. So it's that kind of economic impact, economic assessment of the impact of cutting non-domestic rates that I'm interested in.
I understand the point that's being made. First of all, on council tax, the Parliament is within its rights, as we have done, to set the multipliers in the way that we see fit, and that raises, as we know, £111 million and more for local services. And every penny raised through council tax will be retained by every local authority in Scotland, and it is at the discretion of local authorities as to by how much they raise the council tax. But you know, this government was elected on a manifesto proposition to cap council tax at 3%. We weren't, of course, the only party that suggested a cap on council tax. And other parliamentary parties have gone into Scottish Parliament elections with a position on council tax. So the Parliament, therefore, the government's within its rights to set out an expectation of what we want to happen. Many people said that the council tax freeze for a period of 9 years was unsustainable. We're now giving local authorities the discretion to lift that, and I want to do it through partnership. Now, some of the intelligence I'm now receiving is, you know, very few councils would want to raise it above 3% in any event, but I'm holding true to the manifesto in which this government was elected. And right now, I'm in a positive dialogue with COSLA, and I've also given the Scottish Local Government Partnership the courtesy of engagement as well, but I negotiate with COSLA to achieve that, but it is a matter for each local authority. On the economic modelling around non-domestic rates, I happen to believe that the support for the small business bonus particularly has saved many of our town centres, frankly. I mean, I did an analysis of my own community, my hometown in Renfrew, to see that many town centre businesses paid no rates whatsoever or reduced rates as a consequence of that policy. So I might not have report after report after report to tell me that it's made a difference, but I know that it's made a difference from my engagement with the business community, my engagement with local businesses, and what I see, that I am sure that it's made an impact on the sustainability of town and village centres across this land. And what evidence have I got of that? Well, Andy Willocks of the Federation of Small Business says so. By giving full rates relief to 100,000 Scottish firms, the Scottish Government has lifted the prospects of smaller businesses facing a tough 2017. Or Liz Cameron, the Chief Executive of the Scottish Chambers of Commerce, very much welcomes the Scottish Government's decision to match the business rates poundage to that south of the border. And she goes on welcoming other elements of the business rate package. So clearly, you know, folk in the business community recognise that it's the right thing to do. But I have targeted our support to small businesses and medium-sized businesses in particular, you know, whilst reducing the poundage for all businesses, but targeting support there. And I think that has supported the small businesses across Scotland. I think that's why it's been so warmly welcomed by ratepayers across the country.
But just to clarify, you have no evidence of that. I mean, you talk about anecdotally speaking to businesses in your own constituency, well, but bear with me. But I mean, if I were a landlord in Renfrew, and I was seeing business costs go down, I would just be jacking up the rent. So I'm talking about the economic impact in the medium and long term.
Well, Mr. Wyman, I'd simply throw back at you what you're using is anecdotal evidence to challenge my
I'm not putting forward any evidence. I'm asking you,
Mr. Whiteman. Just let the cabinet secretary respond, and I'll take you back in after that.
I think you were trying to make the point that if I reduce business rates, all that happens is property owners might put up rents. I'm sure that does happen in some cases, but I don't think it's universal. And I think overall, the benefit of our non-domestic rates regime is one that will support sustainable economic growth, and I think has been a lifeline to town centres and villages across the country. I could also add, of course, that I propose to increase the rural rates relief from 50% to 100%, just for completeness. But on small business bonus, I do think it's made a major impact. And if there's any evidence that it hasn't, I would like to see such evidence. I believe that it has, and I'm not alone in that. The Federation of Small Business did carry out a survey, and it did show that it was a very popular and effective policy in supporting small businesses.
I'll leave it there. I'll leave it there.
Kenneth Gibson.
In fact, the first question that Andy asked about non-domestic rates was almost word for word the one I was going to ask, although the figure of £200 million should actually be £162.7 million. But is it not the case that Colin Borland of the Federation of Small Businesses said in 2011 that without the small business bonus scheme, one in six small businesses in Scotland would have went to the wall?
I'm familiar with that quote, and I believe it because, let's face it, there have been quite turbulent economic times between the crash and other pressures, and I think town centres have had particular pressures as well. That's why the government endorsed the town centre first principle and has supported small businesses and targeted a release to small and medium-sized enterprises as well. So I think that all members should reflect on that that comment. And I suppose it's an overall approach to taxation that we are trying to be more progressive, and I think that this approach fits within that.
I've got no doubt that the Small Business Bonus Scheme helps small businesses survive and thrive and hopefully become bigger businesses, employing more people and contributing to our overall prosperity. But I want to ask specifically about the local government core budget. I think one of the frustrations members of the committee has is obviously the fact that we've seen the impact on the core budget of your statement, but we don't have a breakdown by a local authority of all the additional monies that's been talked about, the convener and others. But if we look, for example, in terms of the core budget with the additional council tax through the increase in the bandings, if we look, for example, at my own North Ayrshire authority, the core budget will be down 3.863 million. Elaine Smith's North Lanarkshire will be down 14.401 million. But yet, East Lothian will be up 1.413 million. East Renfrewshire will be up 495,000, Stirling 699,000. And that's obviously because they're more prosperous authorities in North Ayrshire or North Lanarkshire. So I'm wondering, when these new figures come in terms of the additional monies that are coming in from health and social care, integration, etc., will that be evened out to ensure that the poorer local authorities actually do gain additional revenue to be able to compensate for these reductions in their core funding?
Yeah, I think it's a very fair point that if you looked at just council tax in isolation, what other parties in Parliament asked me to do was not to redistribute at a local level, not to do that. So every council keeps every penny of council tax. However, we still deliver the attainment fund. What's more, we increase the attainment fund, which is absolutely delivered on the basis of need. The core grant to local authorities is all distributed largely on the basis of need, the methodology that's in existence between Scottish Government and COSLA. And what's more, there is the floor mechanism as well. You can see people's eyes glaze over when you talk about all these mechanisms, but it's complex as I've described. But the floor ensures that in the range of adjustments to local authorities, that there's support so that there's a bit of convergence around the change in what a local authority may receive. And I'm looking at charts right now. And again, as soon as I'm in a position to do this, as you've requested, convener, for the committee, I'll share this information with you. And what it will represent is when you take together the funding streams, the change to the multipliers, and the ability to raise council tax by up to 3%, and what we're doing around integrated joint boards, it will show you the increase for authorities across Scotland. So, if you look at just core settlement, that totally ignores a range of other funding streams. And again, I say, what are communities most interested in? It's the totality of the package to their community. It's what are you investing in schools? What are you investing in the health and social care partnerships? What is the range of resource going to a local authority? And on that, that's where I can reach the figure of £240 million, 2.3% increase. And what's more, there are further funding streams on top of that that support local services. And as I say, I'll give you all this detail, and what you'll see is what I've said in my opening statement, that the settlement for local government services, is broadly in line with the equivalent increase to the Scottish Government's settlement, which I think helps inform the debate in which some people have made some rather misleading remarks.
Yeah, I mean, I think the frustration is that we've got the total figure, but we don't have the local authority breakdown figure, and I think that's something we're really keen to have. And I would actually take issue with the everything being based on needs, because if you look at aggregate external finance from 1997, when Tony Blair came to power, the local authority was the biggest increase in resource in all that time
per capita has been East Renfrewshire in terms of percentage increases, and the one of the lowest has been Glasgow. So I do think that formula has to be looked at. In terms of moving on to another issue, Convener, capital funding, I was delighted to see a 149.614 million increase in capital funding, about 24% increase, which I think is really welcome, very warmly welcome. I'm just wondering how that will be dispersed again. Are we going to get more information on that and the specifics of that?
Yes, Mr. Gibson is right that one of the main drivers in distribution for the core grant settlement is actually population, and that's right. I know Mr. Gibson's experience from the local government world as well as finance. Mr. Gibson understands this. Population's a main issue. But when it came to readdressing the council tax and attainment fund issue, the £120 million is absolutely distributed on the basis of need, i.e. Recipients of free school meals. And I think that's the right thing to do, because that's actually delivering that funding on the basis of need. And I think for the first time, I've been able to look at council tax and government support in the round. And the reason I do that is to help address that point. You can't just ignore an element of local government financing when you're delivering resources on the basis of need. That's why I keep focusing on the totality of the package, because I know a number of members are very keen to ensure that resources are allocated on the basis of need. Now, specifically on capital, there is a substantial increase in capital. And there is a further reprofiling of capital monies to go back to local government to the tune of £150 million. And that can happen over the next 2 years for the rest of the spending review period. But for this year, that increase is not even the reprofiling of that amount. The capital allocations are in the circular, and I can give the detail to you, unless you want further explanation on how the capital settlements generated from my officials.
Well, that would be helpful, but I think what we're really looking for is when will we have the actual council by council breakdown of all these additional figures? That's really, I'm sure it's looking to be like mid-January, but I just wonder if we can get a specific date on that, because I think that would be very helpful to all members of the committee and indeed the Parliament.
Oh, Convener, I could give you the circular on resource and capital now. I can give you that now. I can give you the capital settlement now, because that's out for consultation with every local authority in the land. But my point was going back to the convener's original point, that if you want the totality of resource, that requires further work because of the timetabling. But I can absolutely give you the capital settlements now.
Well, hold on just a second. I've got some information on capital. I've got, but not the increase. Bizarrely, what we've got in the actual budget document is what the capital was in the draft budget last time, and the capital in the draft budget this time, you know, departmental expenditure limits. And what we've got here is the local authority capital, but for 17-18, but not local authority capital from 16-17. So it's bizarrely, we can't actually look at 16-17 and 17-18 to see what the increases have been in our areas. And yet in the core funding, it's almost the opposite. We've got the core funding, but we've not got the detail of the increase. It seems to me a bizarre way of doing it. And I think what we really want is both what the draft was in 16-17, what is 17-18 for capital and revenue across the board.
Convener, I'll have that information for you by the end of the day.
Thank you.
Okay, that's helpful. And just briefly in relation to the capital monies, we don't want to assume, but we're thinking a huge amount of that might be in terms of the bricks and mortar delivery of our commitment to increasing the nursery estate within Scotland. Would that be right? No,
that's before we even engage in that particular exercise. The capital increases largely at the discretion of local authorities. There will absolutely be an escalation of resources to deliver our childcare plans. That begins this year with a £60 million investment around piloting and the current arrangements. So no, it's not the case that the current capital grant is conditioned on childcare expansion, but absolutely there will have to be childcare expansion in years to come.
So the capital provision is £210 million? Where did the £60 million come from?
The £60 million is the childcare investment for the draft budget. It's not capital. I mean, we're not mixing this up. £60 million is what's allocated for childcare, just to be clear, Convener. That's the beginning of that in terms of training and support. But there is nothing specifically conditioned in the capital grant, is the point that I'm making, for 16 for the next year's financial year around the increase to local authorities. So
the £60 million, which is earmarked in terms of childcare,
is resource.
It's not to put the spade in the ground and say, build an extension to this childcare facility. Let's plan ahead for the Scottish Government's commitment. It's about staffing and resourcing in that revenue stream.
The £60 million is from the education portfolio to begin the process of expanding childcare. It's not the capital resource that you've referred to. The capital resource is local government share of capital. That's the increase that Mr. Gibson's speaking about, and it's not conditioned on the expansion of childcare. Okay. That's the position.
Okay, thank you. Elaine Smith.
Thanks, Convener. Thanks for joining us, Cabinet Secretary. I think, obviously, it would be fair to say that a lot of this is complicated. And we've had council leader after council leader talking about cuts, you know, specifically and if we just take Edinburgh, which is Labour-led with the SNP, the leader's saying it's the worst revenue settlement from the Scottish Government since the onset of devolution. So these are the kind of comments that we're hearing around the budget. And then if we look at the figures, we've got the spice figure of the £327 million cut, but that would seem to be the real terms. You're saying it's not comparing like with like, because you're comparing the draft budget with draft budget. So put that over here. So if we do compare the draft budget with draft budget, then we're looking at a 1.6% cut from the figures that we have here. So if I could just try to drill down a wee bit into that. Your own figures, Cabinet Secretary, talk about £267 million as a potential increase in the total spending power. But within that, that does include the revenue from local taxation. So if the 3% were not to be used, how would that figure be adjusted? Or is that something that you're going to try and come back to us with?
Well, I can give the top level figures, and then what I'll do to be helpful is reference the very local authority you've mentioned, because I think that helps explain the position. So at the top level, if local authorities raise council tax, if every local authority raises council tax by 3%, that should generate round about £70 million. So bear in mind what I've said around the £240 million increase for local government services. That explains it's still an increase, because the multiplier issue happens anyway. That's £111 million. So there's the figure within the top line, the top level of the totality of local government services. And Elaine Smith, I think, is right to pick on some of the evidence that's been received by local authorities and compare that with what I'm proposing in the draft budget. That's a very fair point. And the council that's been name-checked is the City of Edinburgh Council. And if I look across the support that will go to the City of Edinburgh Council and the multiplier increase and the council tax increase of 3%, they will have an increase of £18.5 million as a consequence of all of these decisions. That's an increase of 2.36%. I say the word again, an increase. £18.5 million. Now, that is totality of resource. That is the additional council tax income as well. That is the multipliers and the support to the integrated joint boards, which I've expressed why that matters and why I see that as local government services, because it's supporting that. And I could give you the breakdown within that shows you each element. So I make the point there's a total figure of a £240 million increase. And I say again, there are still further resources on top of that. But when I can break it down to every authority by authority, which I've said I'll share with you, it will show the reality of the financial settlement for local government services is as I have described since the budget.
Okay, I think that would obviously be very helpful, but can we specifically, I want to come on to the integration fund that you mentioned, but specifically, can we say that it's a funding increase when it's based on a 3% possibility, which would actually be a tax increase, clearly not a central government tax increase, which you've chosen not to do, but a tax increase at local level. So you're calling it a funding increase, but actually it would be a local tax increase.
Well, I've explained how that increase gets to that figure. But I tell you what we'll do for the purpose of this dialogue for Elaine Smith. What I suggest you do is, even if you discount the £70 million that could be raised from the 3%, it is still the position that the total package to local government services is increased.
In which case, I think that leads me very nicely into the next question, convener, that I had, which is on the Integration Fund, which I think was explored earlier, tends to be, much of that is to meet the commitment to the living wage for care sector workers. And clearly that is an increase it's financial transfer, if you like, to local government. But the point that was made is, if it's going to be counted in local government, should it also then be counted in health? And I think that's where a lot of the confusion around that has come from.
The position is that the transfer that exists from health to social care is the same as in previous years. There's no double counting in that. It's certainly part of local government services, as we've described, and I think the point's been acknowledged. It features within the draft budget, certainly within the health portfolio, but it's in the local government section as other sources of support, with the explanation in the chapter. So that's explaining the narrative of the position, as we've just discussed at committee. And Elaine Smith has also fairly made the point that it is legitimate to describe as those services, because that's what it's doing. And I kind of take some pride from the fact that we're delivering the living wage and social care. I think it's long overdue, and being able to ensure that it will be delivered year on year now, I think it's a very important step. But it doesn't just deliver that. There's also extra resource for sustainability of services as well, and, as I say, the other discretionary elements around the charging policy too. I said earlier there was pressure on all our public services, and there are, but I think this represents the direction of travel that I thought there was political consensus on, that we need to transfer more from acute to community, and we also need to support local infrastructure to ensure that we're taking the right preventative approach to ensure that there's quality care. And it also properly rewards those within the sector that I think deserve that to be paid the living wage.
Well, I certainly, convener, don't argue with the Minister on that, and would agree about the living wages, I'm sure he'll appreciate. But I do think that it has added to what has been a complicated process, when people like Fraser and the Vallander Institute are saying that the government often double counts this as spending in local services. Clearly, this isn't right. It has to be one or the other. And I think that's where some of that confusion has come in. But I did want, unless the Cabinet Secretary wants to add to that, I did want to move on to talking about the Council Tax Income Bands, E2H and the Attainment Fund. These are the three issues that you mentioned yourself earlier, Cabinet Secretary. So on the Attainment Fund and the Council Tax Banding issue, the committee, as you pointed out, did spend some time on this, and there was concerns raised about it, and clearly the decision was, for whatever reason, that the council tax bands, the money raised from, the additional money raised, £111 million, I believe, from the band E2H, raising of those bands, that could not be taken from local authorities, and therefore there would have to be a different way of working it out. And I think at the time when this committee was considering all of that, it was thought that what might happen would be that the government would reduce the grant to then give funding back to cover this. So has that happened, or is this extra money from central government?
The Attainment Fund is extra money from central government funded through our central resources. On the council tax banning, you're right, we had that discussion, and this government's listened. It's listened to COSLA, it's listened to this committee, it's listened to Parliament, and I think that's a good thing, that the government is willing to listen to other people and change our position, but not compromising our principle, because the principle was that we wanted to give the resource to schools to tackle attainment. Education's the government's number one priority, and we've held true to that and actually increased the amount for the forthcoming financial year around the Attainment Fund, and we're funding it centrally. Just to go back to the other point, because it is just for completeness, that I know the Health Secretary has confirmed this as well, that there is no double counting, because the position on health and social care and the IGBs, it doesn't change the aggregate position in terms of our DEL position for our budget, but I think it is important to set out the context of local government services. And Convener, you cut me off, as is your right, earlier on when I was going to give you a quote, but it is a really important quote when you look at the nature of that integration, I suppose the clue's in the name, integration between health and social care. And the quote was this, for a generation, the elephant in the room in discussions about integrated care has been the artificial distinction between healthcare and social care. Those, including me, who have sought to defend the distinction have sounded increasingly absurd and out of touch. It often takes a crisis to force an issue, if not now, when. That was in 2011 by Stephen Durrell, MP, who was the chairman of the Commons Health Select Committee and Health Secretary. So the point I'm making is this, that local government finance is complex and the integration is equally complex, but it is the right thing to do to ensure that the resources are in place to support people so they get the right care in the right place at the right time, and that's what we are doing through our budgeting, which affects both local government services and the wider, of course, NHS. And as I say, we've raised through the multiplier to be able to ensure that every local authority now has that extra resource, which I think will be very well received.
I think, Cabinet Secretary, Convener, if I may, you know, there's not much argument over the principles around that. But obviously it is complex when people like the Fraser of Allender Institute are getting it wrong and saying it's double counting and you are clearly saying it's not. However, could I just move on to my final question and very brief.
Yeah. We've got, just, it might be worthwhile, Cabinet Secretary, just giving a time check on how much time we've got left for evidence this morning. I'm very keen to take questions from Alexander Stewart and Ruth Maguire and before we finish, we'll run to about 12:15, so if you could make this brief,
so thank you, Convener. Very briefly then, Cabinet Secretary, you're responsible for the whole budget. We're the local government committee, so could I just put it to you that there are concerns that local authorities are facing greater cuts in other areas of the public sector. How would you respond to that?
But I think I was able to outline in the figures that I've given, in the statement that I've given, that the increase for local government services is broadly in line with the increase of the Scottish Government's budget. And as I say, you can see more of the detail of that, but that is absolutely the position. So that accusation is without foundation.
Okay, I shall move on now. Two very patient members of the committee, Alexander Stewart, to be followed by Ruth Maguire.
Thank you very much, Convener. Cabinet Secretary, you talked about initially the attainment fund, and I think at the last time you gave evidence, I was one of the members of the committee who suggested that you were going to be plundering the funds from councils to pay for the attainment gap. And you've explained this morning about how that is now not the case, that you've listened, and I very much welcome that U-turn situation, because I believe that is the right way forward as we progress. You've talked today about new and real and additional funding. You've also touched on fair settlement, but you've also put in the mix the complexities of the financial settlement and how complicated it can be. It can be perceived sometimes as misleading when we have reports coming out from other organisations suggesting there's double counting taking place, and you've indicated that that's not necessarily the case, but to a layperson or someone trying to go through all this process, it is very complicated and it is very difficult to try and understand exactly where the funds are going. But as some of my colleagues have said this morning, local governments across Scotland perceive and see what is happening to them over the next few months and year, that they are going to have to deal with massive cuts across their council areas. And you've responded this morning to say that that maybe is not necessarily the case, that you're giving more funds and you're giving additional money, but there still is this imbalance that, as I say, local authorities are dealing with their budget process at present as we move to the festive season, and then they'll be setting their budgets in February. And all of them that I've spoken to across my region tell me that they are facing massive cuts to services and to facilities that they're going to be dealing with for their clients and for their service users.
This festive season rapidly. Sorry. Do you have a question wrapped up within that?
In all of that, Convener, you know, the Cabinet Secretary today has answered many questions that I had in my own initially, but I still have the question that we are facing a very difficult financial situation across the 32 local authorities. And none of them, as I say, that I've spoken to, perceive that they're going to be receiving additional resources. What they are dealing with is that they're removing services and they're having to streamline and salami slice as they've done in years gone past.
Can I ask, Mr.
No, no, I'd like to respond to some of that cabinet.
Can I ask for one council? Can I ask Mr. Stewart for one council?
No.
You've spoken to
one? I've spoken to a number across my region.
Can I have anyone in your region?
I mean, in Mid-Scotland Fife, you know, I cover the Clackmannan side of things, the Stirling side of things, the Perth and Kinross side of things, which is my own local authority. You know, I sat at a budget meeting last week when they were talking about that.
Good value for money, even though you've waited, Mr. Stewart. That's three local authorities mentioned, Cabinet Secretary.
Well, if I can just do, we'll just do one. I can do more if you like, but so we'll just do Fife then, shall we? So in the Fife area, in terms of the question that I've been asked, again, outlining the position I've outlined around council tax multipliers and IGBs, I've been very clear on local government services. The increase is £15.6 million. That's an increase of 2.4%. I can do the same for any other local authority. But can I refer back to, I know you're short of time, convener, I'm happy to stay as long as is required. Mr. Stewart made a comment that, you know, it's interpretation of some of this. Well, there's the facts, and you'll have more detail coming your way. I suppose I could quote the BBC that says, I think online yesterday, that the government was telling the truth. So were councils, but the government was telling the truth. Who would have thought the BBC, especially after last week, might have said that? But you'll see the information. I have to...
Drift here, Cabinet Secretary.
No, I have to... I'm sure you can forgive me, but... I want to redress something that Mr. Stewart did say, though. He said at one point I was going to plunder local government. At no point was the Scottish Government going to do that. I made it perfectly clear in proposing to change the multipliers that every council would keep every penny of council tax at the local level, but I did say on the basis of need that there would be an element of redistribution within the local government settlement, and people objected to that. We are not doing that, but we were never taking a single penny away from a local authority from their council tax. But what we're now doing, as every member fully understands, is delivering the attainment fund at an increased level from central resources.
Ms. McGuire.
Thank you, Convener. Good afternoon, it is now, Cabinet Secretary. You rightly mentioned that both the public and private sector are operating in quite challenging times. And when we did our pre-budget scrutiny, the Accounts Commission were keen to stress the importance of long-term planning for local government. And I would just be interested to hear your reflections on how the impact of one-year funding rounds has on local government's ability to plan ahead and effectively manage reserves, and also about reserves, whether the Scottish Government takes into account the respective reserve levels of local authorities when setting budgets.
On the question of reserves, no, we generally don't take reserves into account. That is a matter for the local authority to determine what's the optimal level for them. So you wouldn't take that into account in the finance settlement they would receive. As I say, there are other factors around need and population and all the other indicators that drive those figures. So you don't take reserves into account. However, it is valid for politicians to look, and the public and, you know, Audit Scotland and others, to look at local authorities' reserves and make judgments or comments around them, but that's not something that the Scottish Government would generally do. On the timetable of local government settlements, I would say the same of the third sector as well, and actually of the business community around tax propositions. I think people would prefer certainty if that could be given, but I'm sure all members appreciate that this year I was wrestling with deep economic turbulence, a Chancellor who said he was about to reset fiscal policy. I can't remember if that was the Chancellor. No, it was the new Chancellor, not the one before him, George Osborne, of course, who's no longer the Chancellor. There was such economic turbulence, and the autumn statement was to be a major fiscal event. So for all of those reasons, it was possible that the UK government were going to reopen our settlement, and the economic drivers were changing. So all of that led to a view that a one-year budget was the most sensible thing to do in the circumstances, and that's what I've done. Would I prefer to set out a three-year spending review? Of course I would. Would that be welcomed by local government, the third sector and business? Of course it would. But I want an accurate, credible budget as opposed to one that's either ill-informed or subject to so many variables that it would change drastically, and that wouldn't give the certainty that people seek. So I will, of course, through the budget review group that's underway within Parliament, look at the processes of how we do the budget to ensure that we can move as quickly as possible, but it's as well informed as it possibly can be, and it gives longer term certainty. So it's a fair point, but I hope it's equally understood why I've had to make the decisions that I have. And my final point is this. This government has proposed a draft budget to the tune of some £37-38 billion within 3 weeks of the Chancellor's autumn statement, and a local government settlement within hours of presenting the draft budget to Parliament. Why? Because Parliament gets to see it first, and then other elements come as soon as they possibly can thereafter, and that's why we then go into consultation and engagement. And I have to commend the work of the civil service and my officials, who have worked incredibly hard to deliver on what has been required of them by ministers to ensure that we can present these figures as quickly as possible so that we can give people greater certainty. But to the wider timetable question, I'll continue to look at that and see what longer term financial outputs I could possibly pursue.
Thank you.
No, that's fine. Now, a couple of very brief supplementaries, because time is almost upon us. I'll take Kenneth Gibson first.
Thanks very much. I mean, one of the things that came out of the Accounts Commission last week was that local authorities should actually do medium to long-term planning, and they expressed concern that of the 32 local authorities, three, Glasgow, for example, being one, was not carrying out medium to long-term planning, meaning that they weren't able to optimise services. Is that a concern to you? And just to go back to what I asked earlier, in terms of the figures, will we also get the figures for each local authority in terms of how much 3% could possibly raise for each local authority?
Yes, I can provide those figures. The total figure, and I've outlined the methodology. So Glasgow, since it's been mentioned, is an increase of £27.7 million, and that's an increase of just over 2%, again, just for completeness. And longer-term planning, we of course all take advice from the audit bodies and other experts, of course we do, in terms of longer term planning. And you know, I'm sure local elected politicians will be thinking frankly about the council elections at the moment, but there is a real need to look at the long term planning within local government. And I would say again, this is a subject that Mr. Gibson and I have often discussed. There is still more room, frankly, for efficiency and shared services and procurement and a direction of travel with local government that can do even more with the resources that they've got. But we should do that in partnership, and we should do that right across the public sector as well.
Thanks, Kimia.
Elaine Smith.
Thanks, Convener. Cabinet Secretary, I understand that after the original allocation figures had been given to councils, then they had to be contacted again for a revision of those allocation figures because some were wrong. So that in some ways, that, I mean, I'll give you one example here, which was Edinburgh City Council originally allocated £699.4 million being put down to £691.5 million. And I appreciate other councils, I think, were revised upwards. It's just to ask you about that and perhaps some explanation of how that happened and how the councils reacted to that.
This is a matter of process. This is the point of the local government circular. The settlement letter goes, the circular goes to the local authority. COSLR are engaged with it as well. Local authorities check, there's engagement to see are any of the factors, the determinants right. And then there is adjustment. There's been adjustments before, there's adjustments again this year. That's the point of the consultation. That's what the exercise is meant to do, and the adjustment was made in a further circular the next day. So the first circular went out one day, immediate engagement from COSLA, officials, councils engage through COSLA, officials meet, engage, address it, and the new circular is reissued and councils engage with that. And then there's further work, joint work between our officials, and you arrive finally at the position on the order that comes to Parliament about what actually is released to local government. This is a matter of process, it's technical adjustments. It's always been the case. There's been adjustments in the past, and there was an adjustment this year. But because of the timetabling issue, I suppose it's happened much more quickly than ordinarily would have been the case.
Well, in the councils, we're perfectly cool with that
process. I think when the councils look at their settlement letter, they'll say, oh, how have you arrived at those figures, or what are the drivers behind it? And once you understand that, they come back through COSLA to officials, we engage, we adjust and reissue it. My understanding at the moment is COSLA are content with the current circular adjustments made in proposition in terms of those technical arrangements, and what's still a matter for debate, discussion, agreement is whether individual local authorities accept my offer or not.
Yeah, but and that's by the 13th of January, but I think that's that was something important to clarify, if you don't mind, Cabinet.
No, I agree it's important to clarify, and I'm delighted to have been given the opportunity to clarify it.
Okay.
Thank you, Elaine Smith. You mentioned Glasgow City Council in reply to a question from Kenneth Gibson, which has been very helpful for the committee. Of course, as a Glasgow member of the Scottish Parliament, the funding position of Glasgow City Council of particular interest to myself. Now, Councillor McAfee, the leader of the administration for Glasgow City Council, gave evidence to this committee in relation to budget scrutiny. Beforehand, he said publicly in relation to cuts. He gave evidence to the committee, he spoke about cuts. After your budget cabinet secretary, he spoke about cuts. After he knew the numbers that you've used today, cabinet secretary, but what you've said today is there's 27.7 million cash increase for Glasgow City Council and a 2% increase in support, which is very, very different from what the leader of the council has said, which means we've almost came full circle in terms of local authorities perhaps seeking to make the financial position almost as a bargaining chip with national government look as under pressure or as dire as possible, and governments, for pretty obvious reasons, trying to make the position look as generous as possible. And sometimes the truth lies somewhere in between. But I listened very carefully to the figures you gave there, which was helpful given the fact that Councillor McAfee to give evidence into this budget process, and the committee will look at that. Yes, Cabinet Secretary?
No, I just want to point out that you've heard me explain the methodology. It's increase in resource and capital, the multiplier, if that's a council tax issue, the potential to increase council tax by 3%, and of course the funds for the IGB, the integrated arrangement, and that's what gets you to the local government services figure that I've described for Glasgow City. But you know, I could add to that figure and say, and add in city deal and other funding streams. So that's not even the total final position for that area. There is more in the total resources that go to that area. And that's why I think that we do have to look at local government services in the round. I know that politics is going to be played out in local government finance, especially as you enter local government elections. But these are the facts, these are the figures, and I'm happy to share it all with you, Convener.
And the reason for illustrating that, Cabinet Secretary, is we'd like to share it with us long before the 11th of January, which is when this committee has to sign off on our budget report back to the Finance Committee. And I think members will want the opportunity to look in detail at the numbers that you do provide, Cabinet Secretary. And I think a breakdown rather than just the headline figures would be very helpful in relation to that. But I think it is just an appeal again that in future budget processes, I think it would be helpful if, whether it was Spice or our researchers or members, didn't have to thumb between various documents and circulars to get the actual position as purported by the Scottish Government. And there must be a better way of doing this in the future. Now, I'll leave that hanging, Cabinet Secretary. Time is upon us. Do you have any final remarks you want to make before we move to the next part of our evidence session?
I have no further remarks if there are no further questions.
Okay. Well, thank you very much, Cabinet Secretary, and your team for coming along this morning. And we do now move to agenda item 3, which is in private. So we now move into private session. Thank you.